For decades, culture and protest worked hand in hand.
We shall overcome.
In the 50s, folk music with civil rights.
At home, protest against the war persisted.
The 60s, Woodstock and Vietnam. And then came disco. A time that conscience seemed to forget. But there was more to disco than meets the eye. Much more. On closer examination, this is in fact a subtle form of training. This polyester, a uniform. All this apparently random movement is in fact the formation of a secret army. Now, at last, we can see beneath disco's carefully vapid veneer to its true aim, the mass liberation of gays, blacks, and women from the clutches of a conservative, rock-dominated world.
Think about Donna Summer's Love to Love You Baby, right? It actually becomes the musical expression of the feminist critique of three-minute sex.
To my mind, I think Village People are one of the most incredibly subversive groups ever.
It required a de facto army of DJs, record moguls, and denizens of the night in an operation kept secret perhaps even from the operatives themselves. Clearly, a movement of this scale required revolutionary masterminds. While we can only speculate as to their actual identity, through the evidence of their legacy, their story can at last be told. Consider the freedoms we enjoy today. Freedoms we take for granted. Imagine the world before disco and the battles through which these freedoms were won.
I think that the only way to make sense of this is to understand that it occurred in a context of economic downturn, deindustrialization, resurgent feminism, affirmative action, and the sense that everybody else is getting ahead except for the white guy.
It was a bleak time. I mean, the country was in tatters, and New York City was in economic chaos. It was a disgusting, hideous place to be, and they called it Fun City, but that became ironic because it was rat-infested and skanky, and not skanky in the good way, in the right ways.
Where revolutions passed would exploit such conditions to stir the masses to armed revolt. Disco's masterminds instead contrive to cast a unifying spell, which they incubate in nightclubs.
Disco really took hold in this environment. It was much cheaper than going to see bands. You could go to these, you know, new, very exciting, edgy kind of places. And this is really a place where New York nursed itself back to health.
The masterminds first persuade rock musicians their services are no longer required in nightclubs.
Nightclubs began to do a shift with moving chairs from seating area to make room for a dance floor.
Driving the dance floor is the sound of Philadelphia, a softened, string-heavy, post-Motown cousin of funk with a steady 4-4 beat.
Disco is a little bit, as they say, four on the floor, more of the boom, boom, straight bass drum beat.
I think the thing that distinguished the disco era is when it became, I believe, specific with the pss, 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 pss sound to it.
The Loft, disco's first nightclub, demonstrates on a small scale the immediate social benefits of the disco spell.
It was a very, very mixed scene, mixed racially and sexually, and very open and casual.
But there's nothing casual about disco's recently revealed roots.
You can trace disco's roots back to France under the Nazi occupation. In the 30s in Germany, particularly in Hamburg, there was a group of kids called the Swing Kids, who were middle-class, upper-middle-class teenagers who loved jazz. And because jazz was made by African-Americans, largely on labels owned by Jews, it was anathema to the Nazis. There's a club that opened in 1941, I think, called La Discotheque, and there'd be somebody playing jazz records. I think there's a pretty clear connection between the Swing Kids and La Discotheque and just the form of somebody playing specific records for a crowd of dancers.
As disco's spell spreads, so the DJ's role expands.
They became able to sort of manipulate the crowds and, you know, again, building them up and crashing them down and building them back up again. That was what the DJ really did.
Previous revolutions had blamed drugs for diluting the message, but disco...
There was a lot of drugs. It seemed like the drug of choice was amyl nitrate, poppers, specifically on the dance floor.
Some clubs were a little more dirty than others.
Loft protege Nikki Ciano opens The Gallery, where he further refines the spell.
I created atmosphere. You know, I controlled, in my booth, I controlled the lighting, I controlled the air conditioning, I controlled every light in the room. Like if there was a couch in the far corner with a little lamp by the couch, I controlled the lamp. I could really make it insanely trippy, as we used to say.
Seemingly overnight, 100,000 New Yorkers find themselves irresistibly drawn to spend their Saturday nights under disco's spell. Rock Bible Rolling Stone recognizes the scene's new sound as a genre unto itself. To spread its message to the next level, disco now needs the full might of the music business. But disco has yet even to appear in Billboard magazine.
If you're not on the Billboard and you have a record out, then you ain't happening. That's how powerful the Billboard chart is.
The traditional way to break a record would be through the usual industry channels, which would be to try to get the radio stations to play it, ads, music papers, things like that.
You could have the greatest record in the world, and unless you promote it, it's the world's best kept secret.
The disco records had none of those. They were not promoted at all.
The masterminds decide to emerge from the shadows using their nightclub agents to flex some market muscle.
The first real example of this was Manu Dibango's Soul Makossa in 1973. This was a very obscure record from Cameroon.
DJs started becoming very, very big at that time. And if they played that song and got people excited about it, those people would go out to the record stores and they would ask for that record, and if they didn't have it, they'd go to where they did have it.
It was an African import. So we had to go to like to a Brooklyn store that just sold Jamaican records. And I'll never forget, I went in and I bought like 5 copies of it, and we handed it out to our friends and we started playing it.
It made the Billboard charts, which was, you know, unheard of for a completely obscure African record, and that its success was due solely to discos.
Disco's early success on the R&B charts is all the more subversive given what had preceded it.
4 days of rioting, looting, and arson rocked the city of Detroit in the worst outbreak of urban racial violence this year. Entire blocks of homes become infernos. At least 30.
In Detroit, only a few years earlier, amid race and class rioting, R&B songs not intended as protest took on new meaning.
Disco comes about after this very, very fertile period of what I would call black protest songs.
By the 70s, artists like Stevie Wonder are writing deliberately socially conscious songs.
There's all this music that speaks to a sense of disillusionment and disenchantment and this kind of questioning or querying of community that is all over the airwaves, and it's immensely popular. I mean, you can hear it in Stevie Wonder too, you know, Living for the City.
Often,
Such material causes conflict with apolitical record companies like Motown. Disco must find a different road.
Song after song after song. And I think in a certain sense, it got to the point where it was too much. And I think it's also possible that continuing down that road would only lead to music that felt cliched in a certain way. If you were looking at African-American producers, musical producers and musicians and writers who had felt very much in a straitjacket, when it came to the kind of, I mean, really when it came to their musical ambitions, disco becomes their kind of weapon against the idea that African American music has to sound like James Brown or Wilson Pickett. It can actually sound sophisticated and cool. You know, it doesn't have to be raw and spontaneous.
I remember even in Billboard back then, the R&B charts were way in the back, in the book.
Historically, Billboard had Pop 100 Now, which was its pop, quote-unquote pop chart, and it also had an R&B chart, which was originally called Race Music Chart, and it basically charted African-American music.
It was hard for artists, for black artists, to cross over to pop music back then. It was very difficult. You get into that black track, and that's where they keep you, that's where you stay. You never, you know, move from there.
When disco started to become big, there was more of a coming together again of black music and pop music.
Still, rock-dominated radio stonewalls disco. And may well have kept it segregated, but for the work of foot soldiers like Nicky Ciano.
We were hanging out with the promotion guy for 20th Century Fox. We went to his office one day, and we saw albums, just tons of them, and it had a woman with a big afro on it. We thought it was like a kind of kitschy like picture to have and hang on our wall. So my friend David said, "What's that?" And he said, "Oh, we're throwing these albums away." And I said, "Okay, well, give them to us." Well, it was Love's Theme and it was Barry White. And we started playing them and it went to number one. And this was something they were going to throw away. And we took it and made it a hit record.
Disco really didn't operate in the same sort of political register. It was very often around issues related to, for instance, women's sexual pleasure.
You know, many times as we made love and shared love, it's just not enough. It's not enough, baby.
You really find male vocalists writing songs and singing songs about women. It's what you want, babe. It wasn't about what he wanted.
Disco has found a vessel for its message the industry can no longer afford to ignore.
Now,
the music business, being a business, wanted to figure out how to make money off of all this.
And if the dance floor got crowded during the record being played, we knew we had something. And if everybody sat in their chairs, it was like, okay, get rid of this record.
And once the label saw this kind of attention happening and saw that a record could be big on club play, they wanted to figure out how to make another one, how to make another hit.
But no movement can go global without brand recognition.
In 1972 and 1973, there was no word disco. People didn't say, oh, I'm going to the disco. It wasn't used. It was like, we're going to the party, we're going to the club. Disco didn't come in until like 1974. New York Magazine did a cover story about us and The Loft, and they put the word disco in there, and that was it. That was when disco started to be used.
But not all involved are aware of the mastermind's larger strategy.
I became very confused when they started calling it disco because I was making R&B music. So I was torn between, do I become disco now, or am I R&B, or what am I?
In 1974, you had the word disco on a record, and it sold 300,000 copies without, people didn't even hear it, they just bought it.
Now disco is poised for its biggest battle yet.
Up until 1971, there was no other outlet for the record industry but radio.
Radio had this attitude, if we don't play it, it don't sell.
So there was all this payola and all these things going on with radio to get them to play records. And along comes clubs, and all of a sudden we're playing records, and they go to number 54 on the Billboard charts, and they're not on the radio yet.
And now all of a sudden there was another market that they had no control over, that they were forced to play.
Radio was freaking out, record companies were freaking out.
We never could say goodbye. When that started to hit, the radio stations weren't playing it. So then in Billboard, they put a whole page saying, will somebody explain to me how a record can sell 20,000 copies in New York City a week and not one radio station is playing it? How can this be? And finally the radio station started playing it.
Soon, rock stations across the country succumbed to disco. Its spell liberates even radio's format. Fewer commercials to interrupt longer songs. Having lured the masses onto the dance floor, the masterminds have them ready for the next level of unification.
Dancing in the 1960s was done largely individually. There wasn't really touch dancing. Disco really changed that, and that was specifically with the hustle. Van McCoy's The Hustle was number one. The hustle craze had pretty much taken over the country.
In my mother's day, it was called the Lindy Hop. Then it would turn to the swing. We called it the hustle, but it was still dancing, two people dancing together, holding hands, the guy swinging the girl out, bringing her back into him.
The hustle was really, which I never was good at. Oh! That's partnering, you know, that dancing with a partner. Okay, Thumb, I'm gonna throw you now. I'm just...
The hustle itself mutated into dozens of different forms. You had the Latin hustle.
It was the bump. Rock steady. There was one called the slop. And then there was another one that did something like this. I can't remember the name of it. Oh, God.
And I would immediately start leading. You know, I was terrible.
It was one that you was kind of hopping up and down where you almost looked like you were crippled, you know, like.
The hustle finds disco partners even on the political right.
It was hailed by certain commentators, and particularly William Safire, who was a New York Times op-ed columnist and a former speechwriter for Nixon and Spiro Agnew, as sort of a return to conservative values. You were dancing with a partner, you had to engage with each other, communicate. There were return of standards, as he put it. Unbeknownst to him, the hustle developed in Hispanic ghettos of New York City in the early 70s, very specifically with gang culture, particularly the Savage Skulls, who are a rather notorious gang.
Such unorthodox allegiances help spread disco's message even further.
He started Casablanca with only one act, and that was Kiss.
Casablanca Records is founded in 1973 by Neil Bogart, a whiz kid with 60s bubblegum music.
In the mid-70s, when disco really started to go mainstream, a label called Casablanca really helped its boom. It went sort of supernova. According to legend, there would be somebody pushing a tea trolley through the aisles of the office with cocaine on it, and employees would help themselves. And yeah, that's just how it worked back then.
Disco recruits Bogart's cousin, Larry Harris, Casablanca's VP and minority partner.
We really didn't have much belief that disco was a separate genre until Donna Summer. And we fell into her album, came out with her first single, Love to Love You Baby.
Which was basically a 20-minute multi-orgasm on record. And according to legend, Casablanca's head, Neil Bogart, asked Giorgio Moroder, who produced the record, to extend it to basically 20 minutes, you know, for reasons you can probably imagine.
Longer version came out, busted out of the clubs out of Miami, the gay clubs, and started to spread around the country, and that's how Love to Love You Baby initially happened. And that's how we started to believe that disco can sell records.
And as the records move, so does the message of liberation.
It's important to remember this was the era of the female orgasm, and that's why there was, you know, this sort of outpouring of, and it's why there was this sort of outpouring of concern about the big O. Think about Donna Summer's Love to Love You Baby, right? That ain't any 3-minute song, right? I mean, that is a song, I think it's fair to say, intended not only for extended dancing, but extended lovemaking.
Lay your head down, you're close to me. Soothe my mind and set me free, yeah.
It actually becomes the musical expression of the feminist critique of 3-minute sex.
Love to love you, baby. Oh, love to love you, baby. Oh.
In that way, I think it was political.
The only thing good about I Love to Love You Baby was you had 13 minutes to go to the bathroom and do what you wanted to do.
With Donna Summer, Casablanca discovers the recipe for manufacturing disco hits. Step one, find a producer.
Disco, for the most part, as I felt, was a producer in a concept situation.
You have to start with an idea, a song, or a concept, or a gimmick, and after that, you needed the singers.
We could deal with one guy who was a producer, usually without a problem. And we could also get numerous projects out of them, not just one artist.
Make a record cheaply.
It wound up that we could do a disco album for $20,000 or $30,000 when a rock album was $100, $150.
So they saved money on artist development, whereas back then, you know, you spend all this money on Janis Joplin and Jimi Hendrix, and they screw you over by doing... They didn't have to do any of that stuff.
Cover art.
The album, because it was so large, gave you the ability to use some great artwork. We believe that the sexier and hotter looking with the art popping out and colors popping out was going to help sell records. In fact, we really upset some people. There was one album, I think it was The Love and Kisses, where the woman's t-shirt was being ripped open and it looked like it was a violent act. It wasn't. But it was pretty sexy looking.
Court the DJ.
I can't tell you how many nights a limousine was sent for me to take me to, you know, the Savannah Band release party or Grace Jones concert, and all this to play their records.
Get the product to the people.
A lot of Casablanca's success had to do with its promotion. You couldn't walk down the street without seeing Donna Summer.
For discotheques, we made napkins and coasters and glasses with our name on it, our artist name on it, and matches and ashtrays, and I mean, anything we could think of.
At step six, reap the rewards.
People were walking into record stores and asking for what was new on Casablanca as opposed to an artist.
It was an insatiable kind of hunger. It was wild.
Casablanca at one point had more gold and platinum records than the top three major labels in America combined.
Nobody can play this game alone. It takes team efforts to score points with the public. The entertainment business isn't just a matter of luck. You've got to have the right feel for it. No matter who you are, you can't lose with Casablanca Record and Filmworks. Because we play to win, and that's the name of the game.
We got the fire. We got the fire. You got the fire.
With the recipe cooking, the masterminds can enjoy a rare moment of repose.
Everybody wanted to follow, jump on that bandwagon. And very quickly, there were a lot of really horrible formula records. There were several formulas developed, and the labels thought that they could push through that.
Liberation spreads as never before, as producers are brought in to apply disco's hit recipe to already established acts.
Because record companies are always gonna want you. They're looking for the hit. They're like McDonald's and Burger King.
Kool and the gang may never have made their Big Macs had they stayed with their early 70s sound.
Jungle Boogie had a more of a rough edge. I guess you could say, yeah, I'm more of a, if you want to say, male strong. Ugh, get down, you know, how the horns were moving, the bass line with the drums. It was kind of aggressive.
Then their record company brings in hit-making Brazilian producer Eumir Diodato.
And then Ladies Night was more kind of slick to me, though, you know. Da 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 da. Some people said it became more like we were selling out, you know, leaving the funk and going to the pop.
More than just commercial success, the shift brings a woman-identified sound.
This is comparisons in this book. Okay.
And then you have no feeling, no emotion in the records. Everything becomes mechanical. And that's basically what happened. Mechanical records.
And it became less about melody and about content. It became about...
Disco had been adventurous, idiosyncratic, really, really inventive, and coming from all different places, and now they wanted to sort of stream it into something very simple and pop-like.
There was this worry about this whitening of the music.
When the major labels became really interested in disco, they were looking for crossover hits. And so they would whiten, you know, black music in order to appeal to middle America and the mainstream pop audience.
A kind of dumbing down of soul music, a whitening of it, a kind of beiging of it.
But the charge is clearly counter-revolutionary propaganda, designed to detract from disco's social strides.
Disco got this kind of bad rap because it did become, in some sense, I think, the voice of the aspirational. You've got the fire, and you've got the moves. This was music that was really kind of a soundtrack for buppies, for black urban professionals, right? For people, black people who were aspirational, who were moving away from black communities, perhaps living in integrated communities, who were driving fancy cars, who had no real commitment to the civil rights movement and to those struggles. It's certainly the case that there's a lot of disco music that speaks to the aspirational. Now, should that delegitimize it? I don't think so.
But some foot soldiers don't yet recognize their own vital role in the struggle.
As a female artist who did not write my own songs, you don't have a base of power to come from. I had to rely a lot on getting material. And a lot of times it was material that other people thought this would be great for Thelma. And it may or may not be great for Thelma.
I was very aware, and I'm sure a lot of other people felt this too, of the coercion, do you know?
I could get the worst case of laryngitis if you asked me to sing a song that that I didn't like.
They would kind of force you to do things their way.
We had a lot of artists that had maybe one or two hits that, you know, it's not around today. So there were a lot of one-hit artists.
if I do not perform Shame in my sets today, they wouldn't want me at the gig. That's just like saying, Gloria Gaynor did not sing I Will Survive. Everybody would really throw some shoes at her.
And I grew strong, and I learned how to get along. And so young by, from outer space, I just walked in to find you here with that sad look upon your face. I should have changed that stupid lock.
If I ever planned to not sing I Will Survive, I would probably dress in red, because they would probably go back to the old habit of throwing red rotten tomatoes at people.
I will survive. I will survive.
Me, Vicki Sue Robinson on the road, a lot of artists, even Thelma Houston, we were just traveling with disco, you know, one song all over the world you're traveling with that they want to hear the most. But then I had to come out with, you know, you had to keep going. So, you know, we just had to keep going, but it was pretty tough. It was pretty tough.
And in the record business, they kind of treated you like you were a pair of shoes. You know, you make a pair of shoes, you put them in the box. They don't complain. They don't say they want to go the other way around or they want to be painted. They just go in the box, you put the top on, and you sell the shoes. But that doesn't work that well with people.
A love like ours.
It's the only industry, apart from prostitution, that sells a live product.
I said no one could take your place.
But whether or not it's apparent to those on the ground, their personal sacrifices are not in vain.
Disco becomes that opportunity for especially African-American women to challenge notions of respectability. And if you want to get a sense of how we then came to live in an era of Lil' Kim. From Aretha Franklin.
You made me feel like a natural woman.
Well, you can't understand it without understanding disco.
Disco did not develop as many personalities as rock and roll, for instance. The fact that there were a lot of groups from disco that didn't really exist, that were kind of studio things pulled together, became difficult for the labels if that record became a hit, because who were they going to put on Soul Train? Who are they going to send out for track dates and do performances? And if there wasn't someone that someone could identify with, someone visual, I mean, this is, a producer is not going to make a music video. You have to have a singer and a personality.
Well, if the market wants personality, but wait, let's go back. To the two French producers who, in 1974, had given the world the Ritchie family, in 1977, feel a sudden urge to visit New York again, where lightning strikes twice.
To my mind, I think Village People are one of the most incredibly subversive groups ever.
Their new idea popularizes subversion as never before, and it's drawn from producer Jacques Morali's own experience.
Well, Morali, who was gay, was always telling me how life was in some area of those gay cities and how people were dancing, freedom is in the air. What type of freedom? Freedom, be whatever you are and whatever you want to be. Jack was gay, and he wanted to make a statement about the fact that he was and was not shy or ashamed about it. And he also had a lot of humor, and he wanted to do a double entendre thing and still have it work on the dance floor. To do this, we needed some help. That's where Mr. Neil Bogart of Casablanca Record comes.
So it was a no-brainer, and it wasn't expensive. I think the initial album was maybe $60,000 or something, but we knew we had a hit right away.
So we went from 100,000 album sold status to more than 1 million platinum in 2-3 months.
Another disco hit, another fundamental societal shift.
In the years before disco, gay men tended to present in a way that could be characterized as effeminate. And in the disco years, this was the era of the macho man. And anybody who's ever glimpsed the Village People knows what I'm talking about.
Rare insight into the commitment behind revolutions. To this day, these soldiers remain profoundly modest about their contributions.
In this book, called Hot Stuff, which you may or may not know, you guys are called the ambassadors of gay macho.
Well, like I said, we've been called everything.
We've been called a lot of things. As long as they're talking about you, doesn't matter really what they say.
Gay macho, that's kind of anachronism, isn't it?
You know, whatever. You know. What if you aren't gay? You know, it's like, why can't you just be you?
For predominantly the village was gay, mostly all gay. So many people will naturally assume, oh, the group came out of there, so that means that they all are and live that lifestyle. And
I'm not even addressing or interested in whether you are personally or not, just by the way.
You know, it was just so obvious, and that I just think it's so subversive in that sense. I mean, if you couldn't tell that was camp and completely over the top gay.
Tell me about the songs and the kind of double entendre in the big hit songs.
Well, people always talk about the double entendre in the music. There is not one double entendre in any of the music. We were the double entendre.
Explain that.
With Macho Man, we knew that we had to make a joke out of this song because it wasn't recorded to be funny.
Why Macho Man? I was used to go to the bottom of my office in New York. I had a spa. I was going there to exercise because the trend had to, you have big muscle, okay? Jack was very much in men with mustache and big muscles. So we were teasing him about this. That's how came the idea of do the song Macho Man.
These people that were writing this music couldn't write a double entendre.
That's how we produced the first album with those four songs, with double and tender gay things in it.
You mean they really wanted to celebrate life in the Navy?
They were serious about this stuff. Yeah.
They were writing about the Navy, the Navy to join the Navy.
Just so.
know, it's what people took as double entendres were just ridiculous.
Well, let's be frank. We wanted to cross over to be a pop act, and that was the best way to keep sending those double entendre and message, like in the Navy.
Maybe double entendre was the wrong word.
What time do we have?
We have 15 more minutes?
Yeah.
Yes. Yes, no, no.
Jack was used to go to the YMCA to do gymnastic, but also he was trying to cruise. It's a place where you have a lot of young boy, okay? This is why this young man, there's no need to feel down, goes there to the YMCA. That was Jack fantasy.
YMCA was a filler song. There was nothing referenced to, we need one more song. What's that sign say?
Jack didn't know.
He was French for crying out loud. But he really just needed one more song.
He said, qu'est-ce que c'est IMCA?
And I didn't know what it meant back then.
Well, that's the YMCA. That's where you can come from out of town. And
he turned around and he said, great, we're going to write a song.
How we created the gay positive message, simply by being true to ourselves and not lying. When you don't lie to yourself, you don't lie to the people.
We are just a party band. We are not here to save trees, the planet. We want a party, so just in case it is the last day on Earth, you can come to us and have a good time.
And what you find happening as a result of disco music, the sweatbox conditions of those clubs, because they're so hot, men find it very difficult to keep their shirts on. And so men start, you know, flinging their shirts off, right? And if you want to know why it is that every man now virtually feels as though he has to go to the gym or he has to look buff, it's because gay men started pioneering this, really, in this disco era. And in a way that is, I think, best characterized as involving a kind of psychic intifada against the rules of gay life before gay liberation.
Having found the key to mass liberation, make it massively profitable, disco seems unstoppable.
It just spread like wildfire. Once the record companies saw the power of discos to influence record buyers, disco spread like a virus.
Täytyy päästä oikeaan disco feelingiin, että tämä onnistuu.
Their virus of liberation spreads across oceans, transcends borders. Even the Iron Curtain seems powerless to hold it back.
Oikeaa sivulle nostamme lankaa.
The masterminds are now ready for the ultimate propaganda frontier.
Remember, it was not only a revolution in music, it was a revolution in sex, a revolution in fashion. People were dressed, I mean, the best example is Travolta in Saturday Night Fever. That was a moment where something coincided, okay? The music, the fashion, the trend moving, the spirit, a revolution.
Saturday Night Fever is arguably disco's greatest victory, yet its message of liberation for decades remains buried.
The film is, I think, a deeply feminist film, actually. actually.
Hey, you know, you assholes almost broke my pussy finger.
Oh, yeah, you would know which one it was.
The filmmakers are not endorsing beating up on Latinos and making jokes about African Americans.
Would you put your dick in a spick? Does it get bigger in a nigger?
I don't know.
We're supposed to understand that the movie is a critique of those things.
Oh, you know who came in today? This guy David Bowie. He comes in here as this Ascatrian cult, right?
He's Jenny? A faggot.
It's a half faggot, man.
Hey, relax. Come on, sit down.
You mean he's a bisexual?
Yeah, he swings both ways, men and boys.
Saturday Night Fever, I think, really brought up a lot of very mixed feelings in the disco community. The best-selling album at that point, you know, almost in history, was actually a good and a bad thing for the disco scene.
And this movie created all of a sudden the word disco, and all of a sudden there's the disco revolution or whatever. And totally takes away from everything that we had started and gives somebody else the credit for it. Does that hurt? Yeah, it hurts in a way. But I'm gracious enough to just, you know.
I was thrilled because Disco Inferno was in there, and Disco Inferno became a gold record for me because of that movie.
What did that do for your career?
I think it helped.
Really?
I think it helped.
I've only seen one part of the movie, and that's when they use boogie shoes. I've never watched the entire movie.
The people that got hurt more than anybody was the Bee Gees. To have a record like Saturday Night Fever, and all people were saying, it's the biggest selling record of all time, and da-da-da-da-da, and it kind of elevated them and the whole thing. I mean, you talk about overkill.
But ever as mindful as they are masterful, the masterminds worry that amid outward expansion and internal dissent, the message may be diluted. They need a new base befitting the movement's stature. A model nightclub to keep the spell pure, set an example, ensure that core objectives remain the focus. The liberation of women, blacks, and gays.
When Studio 54 came along, there already was a history of gay disco. This wasn't the first disco, it was just the ultimate disco. And it was mixed.
If the rope parted, it was kind of like the seas parting, where you know, now you can come into this spectacular, fabulous place. I don't wanna lose your love, no matter what it takes.
It helped to be gay, and it was actually a time when it was so cool to be gay that people wanted to be with gays. And also, some people even pretended to be gay just to be super cool.
But far from being outed as a temple of liberation, 54's identity is linked to its velvet rope, a powerful symbol of exclusion.
Steve Rubell would handpick people to the point where he would break up a couple. He would tell a married man, your wife doesn't look right, you're gonna have to dump her at the door. And it would be like a Sophie's Choice kind of situation. The guy would think about it and go, bye honey, I'll see you later, and go right in.
So obviously if you're a model, a famous photographer, celebrity, jet setter, royalty, you know, it was very simple to get in. It wasn't that difficult at all.
Studio's new era of celebrity press helped spread disco's message further still.
You would have
arrive at the same time at the studio on a given night with no particular reason. These were our regulars. Andy Warhol, Liza Minnelli, Holston, Bianca Jagger, Truman Capote. They were our fixtures.
Co-owner Ian Traeger even hires a celebrity wrangler.
If I brought a celebrity into the club, Ian and I would have an understanding of what each person was worth. However, it wasn't always an understanding. Okay, because I always thought some people were worth more than he did. Like, we fought about Alice Cooper, because I thought Alice Cooper was worth $120, and he thought Alice Cooper was worth $75. Like, literally. And, you know, I thought Sylvester Stallone was worth $250, and he actually, back then, Stallone was huge. You know, he had done Rocky, so he was as big as you got back then.
Two out there, please.
Studio even inspires disco's greatest protest anthem, Chic's The Freak, co-written by former Black Panther Nile Rodgers.
Originally, that was a song that came about because Bernard Edwards, Nile Rodgers, had been trying to get into a party, and I believe it was Grace Jones' party at Studio 54, and they were denied entry. And originally, Le Freak was Fuck Off, and it was their protest song against Studio 54. So I always sort of thought this was an incitement to, you know, the bridge and tunnel people to go down to 54 and sort of clutter it up even more. And so that became their kind of very, very oblique protest, you know, but perhaps a very effective one.
And it was the ultimate disco. It also was the ultimate hedonistic experience. I don't wanna lose you,
this good thing. They felt free, comfortable. They were like any other human being, drinking, getting wasted if they wanted. Sex, drugs, and rock and roll, dancing the night away. It was a place that was like a candy store for babies.
There was a giant set piece of a cardboard half moon that would come down with a Coke spoon attached to it. And everybody would cheer. It's like such a blatant, you know, worship of the god of cocaine. It's pretty amazing. I think Liza was probably cheering loudest of all.
I didn't even realize that the moon was snorting cocaine. I didn't even know that. It just was a cute thing to me.
But I discovered later that the powder room was really the powder room. I thought that it was for the lady.
Onward, boy, what went on in that bathroom?
There were just people just doing their thing all over the place, just having a good old time, so, yeah.
I was too busy on the main floor just dancing. I should have explored a little more.
And that's what I loved about Studio, was that everybody partied together, no one judged anybody, everybody was there to have a good time. And of course, everybody was high, so.
I've never seen so much cocaine and drugs and people fucking all over the place. I mean, I'd go downstairs in the VIP lounge and you see big stars screwing the busboy, you know? It was pretty strange. Our experience in the clubs of the early 70s was look inside yourself, enjoy, celebrate life. And this was like
abuse yourself, you know? Don't celebrate life, but abuse life, you know? Abuse who you can, use everyone. That was what it was about. I walked out of studio that night, I'll never forget it. And I went out the back door and there was a bum sitting there asking me for money. And I just went, this is screwed up. There's something wrong with this picture.
In spite of all the mastermind's precautions, studio even retains former Joseph McCarthy sidekick Roy Cohn as counsel. Such a cauldron of liberation cannot be permitted to simmer freely. The club has unwittingly placed the movement into the sights of counter-revolution. And its owners are sent to prison for tax evasion.
So this is the, you know, in synthesis, the beginning and the end of an era which only lasted 3 years, I guess. This is why it became legendary.
In revolution, there is a time to expand and a time to contract.
By 1979, disco was a $4 billion industry, and it pretty much dominated America. I mean, you couldn't turn the corner without hearing a disco record or, you know, seeing a Bee Gees poster, and it was just everywhere.
The bigger disco gets, the larger a target it becomes.
Cover of Time or Newsweek that had Donna Summer on the front and it said, disco takes over. And you thought immediately, uh-oh.
You've got that Nazi commie radio station, K-O-M-E. I am Dennis Correctus.
How would you like to be my disco trollop tonight?
I think in 3 years, we probably went around the world about 8 times.
So that when we did other albums after YMCA and in the Navy, people just didn't want to see us anymore. And you know, after a while, you do get tired of looking at the same people over and over again on TV.
Everybody and their mother was hopping on the bandwagon.
The rock bands were actually making disco songs. I mean, Queen and Kiss and
Blondie. They were putting a 4/4 beat on everything. I mean, when Ethel Murray, you know, there's no business like show, and the 4/4 kick. I said, no, I'm not mixing that. I'm terribly sorry. I like Ethel Merman, but forget it. There's no way that's going to happen.
There's no business like show business.
It gave everybody who didn't like disco in the first place the opportunity to say, this is horrible. This is formulaic. This is really, you know, boring, and it was.
It was bullshit.
Downy, 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 disco, down.
Let's disco to Burger King.
Me lost me cookie at the disco. Me lost me cookie in the boogie music. Me lost me cookie at the disco.
The time has come. There is only one thing left to do.
Disco sucks! Disco sucks! Disco-
Disco Demolition Night is a congregation in Chicago's Comiskey Park of 70,000 disco haters. They've been summoned to blow up their disco records by radio DJ Steve Dahl, who recently lost his job when a rock station turned disco.
Okay, listen. I'm gonna go blow up the records real good. Here I go.
Disco ended one day in America, and I remember that day was a very sad day. They were burning records in a big stadium. Disco sucks, also the t-shirts. We felt miserable with Jack. Suddenly we said, what we did? We did nothing. Disco sucks.
Here you do all these amazing things, you bring joy and happiness to people, and you write these amazing songs, and all of a sudden, you know, you're wrapped into this thing now that says disco sucks, so everything you do now sucks? Give me a break.
But the rumors of disco's death are greatly exaggerated. It seems clear in hindsight that even disco demolition is yet another strategic move to draw out disco's enemies and expose them for what they truly are.
Disco sucks is usually understood as being fundamentally a sentiment rooted in homophobia and racism. And I think that there's a lot of that there, if there's a lot of evidence to support that.
You got that gold Coke spoon around your neck? Bought your three-piece suit, you got that on, huh?
The rhetoric was very homophobic. It was very reaffirming the place of white men in society, and at a time where disco was obviously very gay, very effete.
Some people are saying now that the real motivation of the whole disco sucks thing was bigotry, was anti-black and anti-gay.
No.
Even decades on, movement alumni can't seem to break their training of secrecy and cover stories.
I don't think it was a social decision that, you know, we don't want to have these gay people in our dancing in our clubs. That movement came from radio, from people at the radio stations who were really not happy to be playing music that they couldn't relate to.
The record companies screwed it up. Greed, it's ruining the world. I mean, look at the world today. It's all greed is ruining everything.
In fact, we kind of love that because they had to buy records to destroy them, and they bought our records to destroy, so we got some sales.
I think people bought disco records because they liked the music and they wanted to play them, because if you didn't, why did you have disco records to burn in the first place?
It was all about economics. It was, disco had not been quite so successful in that last year, so it was easier for the record companies to abandon it.
So disco actually was crucified. It died.
It literally was banned music.
Burning records. Do you imagine what this means when you come from Europe and you remember the Nazis burning books in Germany before World War II? And it was happening in America. So we were quite shocked.
From December 1978, for more than a solid year, disco rules the pop charts. Then suddenly, on August 25th, 1979, Chic's Good Times is bumped from the top spot by The Knack. Almost overnight, rock music takes over, radio stations reformat, disco, for all intents and purposes, is truly dead. it is here that the Mastermind's trail goes cold. Who they were, where they came from, where they went, no one can say.
In the 80s, it was, I think everybody will agree, it was a desert for disco. And we all thought we were going to die. It's like, what happened, right? The lights were turned out. The clubs closed, and punk came along. And then there gradually became more gay pride events. And that's become a kind of just a tradition.
But somewhere, somehow, a familiar hand seems not altogether to have abandoned the controls.
My Lord, the gay community sucked that song out of the air. Kids like it. Parents like it. The grandparents like it. And it's played at every wedding, every bar mitzvah.
To this day, disco soldiers, battle-weary perhaps, have not given up the struggle.
That was our mentality, not only to make money, but really, really we believed in something. And I'm still believing in it. And if I fight so much after 35 years to keep the legacy alive, it's because I want to make sure that people understand what we wanted to do and why we did it and how it ended and where it will go. And I believe it will go forever.
Now, at last, the political lessons of disco's secret revolution can be unpacked for the benefit of future generations.
As James Scott, the anthropologist who's written about oppressed people developing a kind of hidden transcript, I think it is possible that in this instance, it isn't the case that politics was completely absent. It was that it was scripted, but sort of below the radar in such a way that, you know, sort of people in the know might be able to hear parts of that transcript, but it wouldn't be fully knowable to everyone.
Some people now are saying that it was a kind of protest, was political. Mm. Is that your impression of the disco era?
Not really. I mean, I mean, we didn't see it that way. I mean, it was a time of people going out and going to the clubs and hanging out and having a good time, you know.
Do you think of it as a political time at all?
Political. I never looked at it that way.
The disco is a form of protest?
I want to say no.
I don't think disco was political at all.
You asked me if it's I've never heard that before.
It was more about love.
I mean, when you talk about songs like I Love the Nightlife, that's not a protest song.
Disco is a way to kind of check your mind at the door and just say, let's party down.
I Will Survive, that's not a protest song either.
Things that make people happy, you know, more than preaching or, you know, getting too heavy into what I personally believe or I personally want to, you know, project out there.
I mean, Shake Your Booty, I guess you could say, was kind of a political song in a way, because I was just trying to tell people to get out there and shake your ass.
Just a lot of dancing, a lot of clubs, a lot of movement, and people just having a lot of fun, wanting to be out on the dance floor, just moving, just dancing, just shaking, just sniffing.
Being in the middle of the disco revolution, well, you feel like a revolutionary yourself, but you don't realize it when it's happening.
Yo!
What?
That, should I say his name on camera? That Jamie. Never again, never.
What did he do to you?
Don't read no more books.
You know the song, Jamie?
He's reading too much. You're reading too much.
What's all that noise going down in the jungle tonight? Well, it's somebody feeling the beat and getting ready to fight. Hey, what's that sound? It's the sound of my weapon. Join me.